Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Bryan Lynn and Gena Bennett. Later, Dan Novak presents this week's education report. He looks at the importance of teacher autonomy in classrooms. Finally, we hear today's lesson of the day from John Russell. But first, here is Bryan Lynn.
The administration of U.S. President Joe Biden announced plans Tuesday to increase tariffs on $18 billion worth of Chinese imports. Among the goods facing new taxes will be electric vehicles, EVs, computer chips, batteries, critical minerals, medical products, steel, and aluminum. The White House released a statement about the plan on Tuesday. The statement explained that the move aims to limit what it called unfair trade practices by China. It said U.S. officials were especially concerned that Chinese trade policies on technology transfers, intellectual property, and innovation are threatening American businesses and workers. The U.S. plans come after a four-year examination on trade with China. The examination looked at tariffs put in place by former President Donald Trump, who introduced taxes on about $300 billion worth of Chinese goods. The examination was carried out under Section 301 of the Trade Act of 1974. The Act permits the government to take action against trade practices it considers unfair. Section 301 was also the main tool the Trump administration used to defend its tariffs. China was quick to condemn the proposed new tariffs and urged the U.S. to cancel the plans. A Commerce Ministry statement said the action will seriously affect the atmosphere of bilateral cooperation. The statement also said the Chinese government is prepared to take its own measures to defend its interests. The U.S. tariffs are to be activated over the next 3 years. Tariffs on EVs, solar cells, medical devices, steel, and aluminum are set to take effect in 2024. Currently, there are very few EVs from China in the United States. But officials worry that low-priced models made possible by Chinese government subsidies could soon start flooding the U.S. market. The tariff rate on EVs is set to increase 4 times to 100% this year. The tariff rate for semiconductors will rise from 25% to 50% by next year, White House officials said. Lael Brainard is director of Biden's National Economic Council. She said the tariffs would increase the cost of some Chinese goods. They would also help block China's efforts to dominate the market for new developing technologies. China is simply too big to play by its own rules, Brainard told reporters Monday during a conference call ahead of the announcement. The U.S. Census Bureau estimated that the U.S. imported $427 billion in goods from China in 2023, while it exported $148 billion in goods. U.S. officials have said the latest tariff decision was made independently of this year's American presidential election, which happens in November. But Brainard noted in her comments that the tariffs would help workers in Pennsylvania and Michigan. Both states are so-called battleground states that may decide who wins the election. I'm Bryan Lynn.
In ancient India, the term Buddha was used to describe someone who has awakened from ignorance and gained freedom from suffering. Buddha means the enlightened one. Today, the names Buddha, Siddhartha, Shakyamuni, Gautama, or Thot are used to describe a historical person born around 2,500 years ago. His followers started the religion of Buddhism, which is widely practiced in many Asian countries. Some countries observe his birthday on the fourth month of the Buddhist calendar, which falls on May 15th this year. Others celebrate it on the first full moon of May, which falls on May 23rd. Buddha, or Prince Siddhartha, was born in Lumbini, an area at the border of what is today India and Nepal. His mother, Maya, was the wife of Suddhodana, king of the Shakya families. Ancient storytellers said that Queen Maya dreamed of a white elephant entering her womb before giving birth. The child took 7 steps soon after he was born and received a cleansing bath from the gods or dragon kings, depending on the country or culture where the story is told. Suddhodana tried to keep his son from knowledge of pain and suffering. Before long, the prince witnessed and learned of sickness, old age, death, and the impermanence of life. At the age of 35, Siddhartha was enlightened and became known as the Buddha. Followers use the time of Buddha's birthday to celebrate and to reflect on his teachings and their faith. In many parts of Asia, the day marks the birth, the enlightenment, and passing of the Buddha. In most Asian cultures, Buddhists go to their local religious centers or temples and take part in chanting, meditation, and activities all day. Families decorate their homes with lights called lanterns and gather for big meals. Buddha's birthday is a national holiday in South Korea. The big celebration in the capital city of Seoul is the Lotus Lantern Festival called Yeongyeongho. It is a parade of thousands of colorful, lighted paper lanterns, often shaped like lotus flowers. On Buddha's birthday, many temples provide free meals and tea to all visitors. Other festivities include traditional games and performing arts to mark the light of Buddha's teachings. While Buddha's birthday is not an official holiday in North Korea, it has been observed in Buddha's temples there since 1988. In 2018, Buddhist clergy in North and South Korea held joint services when tensions between their governments eased. But such exchange programs have been halted in the past few years because of North Korea's nuclear program. In China, Buddhists perform a bathing ceremony that involves pouring holy water over a statue of the infant Buddha. The statue has one right finger pointing up to the sky and one left finger pointing down to the earth. This means that with his birth, Buddha announced that he would have no more rebirths, and the dragons of heaven baptized him with pure water. In Japan, Buddha's birthday is observed on April 8th and celebrated in Buddhist temples as Hana Matsuri, which means flower festival. On this day, a small flower hall is set up on the temple grounds and decorated with colorful flowers. Followers pour sweet tea on the head of a statue of the baby Buddha in a bowl of water. And a cleric performs the Kambutsui ceremony, recreating Buddha's birth in the garden of Lumbini. Countries in South and Southeast Asia celebrate Buddha's birthday on the full moon of the second lunar month, known as Vaisakha or Vaisakha. In India and Nepal, sweet rice porridge is served on this day to recall Sujata, a young woman who offered the Buddha a bowl of milk porridge. In Sri Lanka, celebrants decorate homes and streets with candles and lanterns. They sing songs, burn incense, and tell stories about Buddha's life. In Vietnam, Buddha's birthday is still a popular festival, but no longer a public holiday. Between 1958 and 1975, in what was formerly South Vietnam, it was a public holiday. In Malaysia, China, and many other countries, animals and birds are also set free on Buddha's birthday because people believe it is good karma. I'm Gena Bennett.
When teachers at one of the top public schools in Florida are asked how they succeed, one answer is universal. They have autonomy in the classroom. Teachers with autonomy are able to make decisions and plans independently in their classrooms. The majority of American teachers report feeling stressed and unhappy at work, a Pew Research Center study found last year. Another study by Brown University and the University of Albany found that reduced job satisfaction has been connected to a drop in teachers' sense of autonomy in the classroom. But at A.D. Henderson School in Boca Raton, Florida, school leaders permit their staff high levels of classroom autonomy, and it works. Henderson is a public school of 636 kindergarteners to 8th graders on the campus of Florida Atlantic University. Henderson students scored in the top 1% to 3% in nearly every subject in the state's latest standardized tests. In almost every subject, 60% or more of Henderson students scored far above the Florida state average. There is a lot of our own individual input allowed in doing the activities that we want to do in the classroom, said Vanessa Stevenson. She is a middle school science teacher at Henderson. She plans to start a horse medicine class next fall, even though the school has no horses. She believes she will find a way to make the class a success. It's a bit of trial and error, because there's nothing being handed to you saying, do it this way. You just have to figure it out, she said. Joel Herbst is the superintendent of Henderson and its partner, FAU High School. He called the teachers his secret sauce. He said the school's success can be done anywhere if administrators give teachers more freedom. When that happens, he said, teachers create hands-on programs that help students learn more. Give teachers the freedom to do what they do best, which is to impart knowledge to teach beyond the textbook, Herbst said. Madhu Narayanan is an education professor at Portland State University. He teaches teacher independence. He said independence is highly related to teacher morale and success, but independence must be combined with administrative support. It can't be, here is the classroom, here is the textbook, we'll see you in 6 months. Those teachers have tremendous autonomy, but feel lost, he said. About 2,700 families enter a lottery each year for the 60 spots in Henderson's kindergarten class and openings in other grades. Some children entering Henderson are gifted. Some have learning disabilities. Most are average learners, however. The school must follow a Florida law that requires the student population at university-run laboratory schools to match state population demographics for race, gender, and income. Because families apply to attend, parental involvement is high. Jenny O'Sullivan teaches a class on art and technology. Her kindergartners learn computer coding basics by playing a game with a robot. And fourth and fifth graders make videos celebrating Earth Day. Her new classroom has the newest technology. But she says such classes can be taught anywhere if the teacher is given the ability to be creative. Amy Miramontes teaches sixth graders a medical detectives class. They examine pieces of rabbit muscle under a microscope using safe chemicals to find what disease each animal had. Miramontes hopes the class grows students' interest in medicine. She also hopes her class gives students the knowledge needed in 2 years when they take the state's 8th grade science test. Henderson's success has led to more money and grants. The middle school's drone program, for example, recently won a national competition in California. Henderson's drone teams have a room to practice flying the devices through an obstacle course, plus flight simulators donated by the local power company. The drone program is a chance to compete while using the physics and aeronautics learned in the classroom, teacher James Nance said. Eighth grader Anik Sahai is in Stevenson's science class. He created an app that uses the camera to diagnose diabetic retinopathy. The eye disease is a leading cause of blindness worldwide. Sahai's app took first place in the state's middle school science fair and is being considered for commercial use. The 14-year-old credits his success to his years at Henderson, beginning in the preschool program. The teachers here, they're amazing, he said. They've been trained on how to get us to the next level. I'm Dan Novak.
Dan Novak. Novak is here now to talk more about today's education report. Hi, Dan. Welcome.
Hi, Ashley. Glad to be here.
Today's story was about how one school has seen success in large part due to the independence and autonomy given to the school's teachers. First, can you define the word autonomy for us?
Yes, something or somebody with autonomy has individual power or independence, as you just said. The word is often used in political terms. In the United States, for example, states have a lot of autonomy to govern themselves. It is not just the federal government with power. Other countries give certain regions autonomy to make decisions as well. So in the context of the story, the teachers at Henderson are given more autonomy over their classrooms. In other words, they have more power and independence about what and how they teach.
And more teacher autonomy is related to more job satisfaction?
Yeah, those are the results of findings from a Brown and University of Albany study. When teachers feel more free to create their own lessons and teach how they want to teach, I think it makes sense that they would be happier at work. I think that goes for most jobs. Some independence is preferred.
One expert quoted in the story said that independence must be combined with administrative support.
You're right. That was Madhu Narayanan, an education researcher from Portland State University. If teachers are given that autonomy, they need to feel supported. School leaders need to do more than just say, here's your class, do whatever you want. Some guidance is needed as well. It's about finding a balance between independence for teachers and support from school administrators. Too much of either can be a bad thing.
That makes sense. Well, thanks so much, Dan, for that report, and thanks for talking with me today.
You're welcome, Ashley.
In this next report, Dan Friedel tells us about a recent scientific study that explored ancient corals, animals that form reefs. We learn that ancient corals may have been the first animals to glow in the dark. Pay careful attention to the word determine. We will talk more about it after the report.
A new study suggests ancient corals found deep in the ocean were the first animals to glow in the dark. To glow means to shine a steady light. Many animals, insects, and sea life have the ability to glow. But a study from biologists based in the United States suggests corals started glowing 540 million years ago. Andrea Quattrini is curator of corals at the Smithsonian Museum of Natural History in Washington, D.C. She was one of the writers of the study. Quattrini said, "The ability to light up helps creatures living in the deep sea to communicate. It's very important in deep waters," Quattrini said. The new study recently appeared in the publication Proceedings of the Royal Society B. Scientists know about many ocean animals that light up, including fish, squid, octopus, jellyfish, and even sharks. The ability to glow is called bioluminescence. It comes from a chemical reaction. Some animals use the light as protection. Others use it to find a mate. Stephen Haddock is another study co-writer. He is a marine biologist at the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute in California. He explained that scientists used a paintbrush attached to an underwater vehicle to lightly touch the luminous coral. Haddock said the coral, when touched, begins to glow pink, orange, white, blue, and purple. Danielle DeLeo is another study co-writer and a marine biologist at the Smithsonian. She said, "In some kinds of coral, the whole body glows, In others, only parts of their branches will glow, she said. Scientists do not fully know the function of the glowing for coral. They do not know if it is meant to attract or keep away certain organisms, or possibly both. But DeLeo said, the fact that corals light up so often means that the glowing serves a critical function. It is one thing to try to learn about why the corals light up, but how did the researchers determine that coral had been glowing for over 500 million years? To answer the question, the scientists built a family tree using genetic data from 185 species of glowing coral. They decided the common ancestor of all the glowing coral lived 540 million years ago and could glow just like the current coral. Before this research, marine scientists believed the earliest example of a glowing sea creature was a shrimp that lived about 270 million years ago. Coming up with an age of the earliest glowing coral helps add more information to the timeline of the development of life on Earth. The oldest glowing coral is now placed in the time of the Cambrian explosion, when life on Earth developed quickly. I'm Dan Friedel.
Before the report, we asked you to pay careful attention to the word determine. Can you remember when you heard it? You heard the term used to describe an action on the part of researchers. Let's listen again.
It is one thing to try to learn about why the corals light up, but how did the researchers determine that coral had been glowing for over 500 million years?
Determine is a verb. We spell it like this. D-E-T-E-R-M-I-N-E. Determine has a few different meanings. For the purposes of today's lesson, we can define it as this. To find out about something or come to a decision about something by reasoning or calculation. It suggests the idea of coming to a conclusion. So, when you heard the structure, "How did the researchers determine?" in our report, the verb determine strongly suggests reasoning and calculation. Determine appears in many different kinds of news stories. For example, a local newspaper might report a death. The news report might say, "Investigators determined the cause of death to be." In other words, the investigators likely used reasoning and calculations in order to come to their conclusion about the cause of death. Now that we have explored the meaning of the verb determine, we can turn to building our ability to pronounce the word. We can divide the word into three syllables. Determine. The stress is on the second syllable, ter. Listen and repeat after me. Determine. 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 And that's the lesson of the day. I'm John Russell.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.